I just don't believe in it. They wanted me to impeach President Bush for the Iraq War. I didn't believe in it then. I don't believe in it now. It divides the country.
In early 2019, Nancy Pelosi warned against impeachment, telling Democrats it's a path they shouldn't take.
Well, Speaker Pelosi has made clear now for months that people should take caution before they go down the pathway of impeachment, and now she's going in even further, saying in an interview with the Washington Post, quote, I'm not for impeachment. This is news. I'm going to give you some news right now because I haven't said this to any press person before, but since you asked, I've been thinking about this. Impeachment is so divisive to the country that unless there's something so compelling and overwhelming and bipartisan, I don't think we should go down that path because it divides the country and of the president. He's just not worth it.
Yet, after no bipartisan support and two Democrats breaking ranks, Pelosi domineered the start of the impeachment process.
Therefore, today, I'm announcing the House of Representatives moving forward with an official impeachment inquiry. This is a sad day. It's a sad day because nobody comes to Congress to impeach a president of the United States. No one.
No one? As recently as the 2018 midterm elections, freshman Democrats ran on the premise of impeaching Trump.
People love you, and you win. Woo! And when your son looks at you and says, Mama, look, you won, bullies don't win. And no. I said, baby, they don't, because we're going to go in there, we're going to impeach the
I am not running for anything except the impeachment of Trump.
In fact, the topic of impeachment was discussed in some circles, including officials in the Department of Defense, as a backup plan in case Trump won the 2016 election.
And actually, if Donald Trump were elected, I believe he'd be impeached pretty quickly, or somebody else would have to take over government.
And ever since Trump won, Democrats have admitted that impeachment is just a political weapon to prevent his re-election.
I'm concerned that if we don't impeach this president, he will get re-elected.
This is about preventing a potentially disastrous outcome from occurring next year.
I'd like to impeach the bastard right now.
I will fight every day until he is impeached.
I think the only thing that we can do is to start that impeachment inquiry.
I feel very strongly back sometime that, in fact, we met that threshold.
We must open an impeachment inquiry.
We have come to the time of impeachment.
Impeach 45! Impeach 45!
So what exactly has Trump done to be impeached? It began with the whistleblower complaint, which alleged a White House cover-up in Ukraine.
The whistleblower's complaint at the center of the storm in Washington, the center of this new impeachment inquiry involving President Trump. That complaint now made public tonight, and what it alleges, saying some White House officials tried to cover up the call with the president of Ukraine, trying to conceal the transcript of the call on a separate, highly secure computer system.
What the media failed to report, however, was the unusual circumstance under which the report was filed. Federal records show that the intelligence community secretly revised the formal whistleblower complaint form in August 2019 to eliminate the requirement of direct firsthand knowledge of wrongdoing. A previous version of the whistleblower complaint submission document stated, in order to find an urgent concern credible, the ICIG must be in possession of reliable, firsthand information. The ICIG cannot transmit information via the ICWPA based on an employee's secondhand knowledge of wrongdoing. This includes information received from another person. Trump's attorney, Jay Sekulow, made the same point on Fox News.
I will tell you this, months ago, no firsthand information, no report. So what is this? This is hearsay.
Compare that to the new whistleblower complaint form, which was revised in August 2019, days before the whistleblower complaint was made public. The new form was modified to include, I heard about it from others.
It used to be required that you had to offer direct, personal, firsthand evidence, or else this particular complaint, which is known as an urgent concern complaint, would be dismissed by the Intelligence Community Inspector General. When we asked the DNI and the ICIG for information on who changed it, when, and why, they straight up refused to answer that question.
Despite the unusual circumstances around the complaint, the Democrats and their allies in the media had all the ammunition they needed to push their impeachment agenda forward. For the children.
So you have to be ready to take a punch. You got to be ready to take a punch. And therefore, you have to be ready to throw a punch. For the children. Throw a punch for the children.
In short, the Democrats and their friends in the media accused Trump of asking a foreign country, the Ukraine, to investigate Joe Biden. They pushed the narrative of a quid pro quo, that Trump would only provide military aid if the Ukraine found dirt on Joe Biden.
The Washington Post is also reporting that Trump ordered a hold on military aid to Ukraine days before his call to that country's president. The Post reports, quote, Trump told his acting chief of staff, Mick Mulvaney, to hold back almost $400 million in military aid for Ukraine at least a week before a phone call in which Trump is said to have pressured the Ukrainian president to investigate the son of former President Joe Biden, according to three senior administration officials.
To prove his innocence and to prove there was no quid pro quo, Trump made the unprecedented move of declassifying and releasing the transcript of his phone call with the president of Ukraine. In true Trump fashion, the president waited until just minutes before the impeachment hearing to release the transcript and debunk the narrative in the court of public opinion. But the Democrats were already committed to their scheme.
We can't be worrying about how long is this going to take or that. It'll take as long as it does. And we will press the case so that in the court of public opinion, people will know what is right. But we cannot accept a second term for Donald Trump.
So exactly what was in the transcript? Well, the transcript was so innocent that Adam Schiff, who spearheaded the hearings, completely made up, or in his words, parodied, the transcript of the phone call. Listen to what Schiff claimed happened on the call, then compare it to the actual transcript on your screen.
Shorn of its rambling character and in not so many words, this is the essence of what the president communicates. We've been very good to your country, very good. No other country has done as much as we have. But you know what? I don't see much reciprocity here. I hear what you want. I have a favor I want from you, though. And I'm going to say this only 7 times, so you better listen good. I want you to make up dirt on my political opponent, understand lots of it. On this and on that, I'm going to put you in touch with people, not just any people. I'm going to put you in touch with Attorney General of the United States, my Attorney General, Bill Barr. He's got the whole weight of the American law enforcement behind him. And I'm going to put you in touch with Rudy. You're going to love him, trust me. You know what I'm asking, and so I'm only going to say this a few more times, in a few more ways. And by the way, don't call me again. I'll call you when you've done what I asked. This is, in sum and character, what the president was trying to communicate with the president of Ukraine. It would be funny if it wasn't such a graphic betrayal of the president's oath of office.
When Schiff was called out for lying about the transcript, the media fact-checked his accusers by minimizing his rewriting of history and labeled it as a parody instead. So what exactly in the phone call was so damaging for President Trump?
The White House released a 5-page memo of that 30-minute call. At one point, President Trump said, "I'd like for you to do us a favor," and pushed for Volodymyr Zelensky to look into Democratic rival Joe Biden.
Did you catch that? The White House released a memo of a 30-minute conversation. Democrats claim that this was the smoking gun of a quid pro quo with a foreign nation for dirt on a domestic political opponent. Yet, Biden was only referenced 3 times in this entire 30-minute conversation. It doesn't take an expert to realize that if this phone call was really about a quid pro quo pertaining to 2020, Biden would have been a larger part of the conversation. In regards to the do us a favor quote, it has been suggested that this is simply one of the president's so-called Trumpisms.
She just did me a beautiful favor, keeping it a beautiful Sikorsky plant open in the great state of Pennsylvania. I'm talking to your ambassador. Jared was there. Jason Greenblatt was there. I said, fellas, do me a favor. You're doing us a favor because of the great job you do. And they called and they said, could you possibly make it another day? And we delayed it 2 weeks. So we did them a favor, but they're doing us a favor. But they're buying a lot of agricultural products.
And I said, would you do me a favor? The remains of these great fallen heroes, can we do something? He agreed to it immediately.
In the rush to impeach Trump before the election, Democrats have overlooked one key point. On multiple occasions, the president of Ukraine himself admitted that there was no quid pro quo.
Felt any pressure from President Trump to investigate Joe Biden and Hunter Biden?
I think you read everything. So I think you read text. I'm sorry, but I don't want to be involved to democratic, open, elections of USA. No, you heard that we had, I think, good phone call. It was normal. We spoke about many things, and I think you read it that nobody pushed me. Yes.
In other words, no pressure.
President Trump.
Because you know what, there was no pressure, and you know there was. And by the way, you know there was no pressure. All you have to do is see it, what went on the call. But you know that. But you could ask the question, and I appreciate the answer. Go.
According to the New York Post, Schiff's impeachment report is empty on evidence. No wonder Schiff refused to let Republicans speak during the hearings.
Mr. Speaker, Mr. Chairman, I have a...
The gentleman's not recognized.
Mr. Chairman, I have a point of order.
The gentleman's not recognized.
I have a point of order, though.
The gentleman's not recognized. I do want to respond. I allowed the ranking member to...
I have a point of order.
The gentleman's not recognized.
Mr. Chairman, there are four transcripts that have not been released.
The gentleman is not recognized.
Holy
the ranking
cow.
Member was allowed to exceed the opening statement. And I was happy to allow him to do so.
Mr. Chairman,
today,
I have a point
today,
of order. Mr. Chairman, I have
not,
a point of order.
The gentlewoman is not recognized.
So we know today, clearly you're going to interrupt us throughout this hearing.
The gentlewoman is not recognized.
Mr. Chairman, I have a desperate consent request.
Today, no.
Mr. Chairman, I have unanimous consent.
The gentleman is not request, not recognized. Today we're
Mr.
Allowed.
Chairman, I have a point of order under HRES 660.
The gentleman will state her point of order.
The point of order is, will the chairman continue to prohibit witnesses from answering Republican questions as you've done in closed hearings and as you did this week when you interrupted our questions?
That is not a proper point of order. The gentleman will suspend.
But even though Republicans were effectively shut down during the hearings, the Democrats' own witnesses actually hurt the case for impeachment. Democrats brought out witnesses who had never even met the president and could therefore only provide hearsay as their testimony.
Mr. Goldman, what I can do here for you today is tell you what I heard from people.
Ambassador, you weren't on the call, were you? President, you didn't listen on President Trump's call and President Lissy's call?
I did not.
You've never talked with Chief of Staff Mulvaney?
I never did.
You never met the president?
That's correct.
This is what I can't believe, and you're their star witness. You're their first witness.
Mr.
You're
Jordan.
The guy. You're the guy based on this, based on, I mean, I've seen church prayer chains that are easier to understand.
There are a number of events you are investigating to which I cannot bring any firsthand knowledge.
You don't have a lot of facts and information relating to the part of this that we're investigating. And those are the events from May 20th up until September 11th, the release of the security assistance funds. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's correct.
Do you have any information regarding the President of the United States accepting any bribes?
No.
Do you have any information regarding any criminal activity that the President of the United States has been involved with at all?
No.
Were you involved in the July 25th Trump-Zelensky phone call or preparations for the call?
No, I was not.
Did you ever talk to President Trump in 2019?
No, I have not.
Mick Mulvaney?
No, I have not.
Thank you, Ambassador. I'm not exactly sure what the ambassador is doing here today. This is the House Intelligence Committee that's now turned into the House Impeachment Committee.
You've never met the President of the United States, right?
That is correct.
So you've never advised the President of the United States on Ukraine?
I advised him indirectly. I made all his preparations for the calls.
But you've never spoken to the President of the United States and told him advice on Ukraine?
That is correct.
Even CNN analysts admitted that it was a problem that Democrats' witnesses hadn't met Trump.
Because the one criticism of these two witnesses, which I think is very much legitimate, it's not really a criticism, it's just a factual statement, is that neither of them had direct contact with the president.
Ever.
Ever. And yeah, that's a problem if you're going to impeach the president.
If anything, Democrats' witnesses actually helped Trump's case. First, they confirmed that Trump never asked for a quid pro quo, that aid to Ukraine was never tied to investigating Joe Biden.
But I believe I just asked him an open-ended question, Mr. Chairman. What do you want from Ukraine? I keep hearing all these different ideas and theories and this and that. What do you want? And it was a very short, abrupt conversation. He was not in a good mood. And he just said, I want nothing. I want nothing. I want no quid pro quo. Tell Zelensky to do the right thing. Something to that effect.
Why that's important, Ambassador Sondland, is because none of that is hearsay. None of that is speculation. None of that is opinion. That is direct evidence. And ultimately, that is what, if this proceeds to the Senate, they're going to care about. Unlike this proceeding, which has been based on largely speculation and presumption and opinion, this is direct testimony and direct evidence. And to that point, none of that included evidence about the Bidens, and none of that included evidence about military assistance, because President Trump never mentioned either of those to you, correct?
That's correct.
All right. So if I were to summarize your testimony, no bribery, no extortion, no obstruction of justice, no abuse of power. Is that fair?
Not on this record.
Mr. Zeldin asked you in the deposition that in no way, shape, or form, in either readouts from the United States or Ukraine, did you receive any indication whatsoever or anything that resembled a quid pro quo. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And the same would go for this new allegation of bribery?
I've only seen an allegation of bribery in the last week.
It's the same common set of facts. It's just instead of quid pro quo, now it's bribery.
I was never involved in anything that I considered to be bribery at all.
Okay, or extortion.
Or extortion.
Okay.
Did you notice Ambassador Volker admit that he hadn't heard about any accusations regarding bribery until this week? It turns out that Democrats' pivot from accusing Trump of a quid pro quo to bribery was a political move, not one based on evidence.
Like the word bribery. And that was a political shift. We all heard Nancy Pelosi do it in her press conference last week. It was blatantly obvious that she used the word bribery intentionally because it packs more of a punch. It is more understandable for people because her goal is to penetrate public opinion. It has been. She's very open about that. And quid pro quo doesn't cut it. And that is a political aim. And, it is what it is. And that is their goal.
It's been reported in the mainstream media, and it goes back to your issue of does crimes matter or what this definition is. Is it House, our majority initially accused the president, and they kept saying quid pro quo, and we still hear it as we go through. But then, as reported, they used a political focus group to determine whether the phrase polled well. And apparently it didn't poll well, so they agreed to change their theory of the case to bribery. Does that not just feed into more of what you're saying about how we're actually, the crime matters and that facts do matter in a case like it, or at least should matter?
It does. There's a reason why every past impeachment has established crimes. And it's obvious. It's not that you can't impeach on a non-crime. You can. And in fact, non-crimes have been part of past impeachments. It's just that they've never gone up alone or primarily as the basis of impeachment. That's the problem here. If you prove a quid pro quo, that you might have an impeachable offense. But to go up only on a non-criminal case would be the first time in history. So why is that the case? The reason is that crimes have an established definition and case law. So there's a concrete, independent body of law that assures the public that this is not just political, that this is a president who did something they could not do. You can't say the president is above the law if you then say the crimes you accuse him of really don't have to be established.
Whether you are a Republican, Democrat, or independent, we should all agree that impeachment should never be a political weapon. Impeachment should be reserved for high crimes and misdemeanors. And yes, just like any other American citizen, the president is innocent until proven guilty. And up until this point, the Democrats have failed to make their case. As always, those are just my thoughts, and I would love to hear yours in the comments below. Please share this video on Facebook, share it with your friends, share it to websites, emails, Twitter, wherever. Follow me on Facebook, facebook.com/stateofdaniel. If you haven't already, please subscribe. I will see you soon.
What my esteemed colleague said was certainly true. If you accept all of their presumptions, it would be obstruction. But impeachments have to be based on proof, not presumptions. That's the problem when you move towards impeachment on this abbreviated schedule that has not been explained to me. Why you want to set the record for the fastest impeachment? Fast is not good for impeachment. Narrow, fast impeachments have failed. Just ask Johnson. So the obstruction issue is an example of this problem. And here's my concern. The theory being put forward is that President Trump obstructed Congress by not turning over material requested by the committee. And citations have been made to the third article of the Nixon impeachment. Now, first of all, I want to confess, I've been a critic of the third article of the Nixon impeachment my whole life. My hair catches on fire every time someone mentions the third article. Why? Because you would be replicating one of the worst articles written on impeachment. Here's the reason why. Peter Rodino's position as chairman of judiciary was that Congress alone decides what information may be given to it. Alone. His position was that the courts have no role in this. And so, by that theory, any refusal by a president based on executive privilege or immunities would be the basis of impeachment. That is essentially the theory that's being replicated today. President Trump has gone to the courts. He's allowed to do that. We have three branches, not two. Trumbull said the following. He said, once this set the example of impeaching a president for what, when the excitement of the hour shall have subsided, will be regarded as insufficient causes, no future president will be safe who happens to differ from the majority of the House and 2/3 of the Senate. He said, I tremble for the future of my country. I cannot be an instrument to produce such a result, and at the hazard of the ties, even of friendship and affection, till calmer times shall do justice to my motives, no alternatives are left to me. And he proceeded to give the vote that ended his career. You can't wait for calmer times. The time for you is now. And I would say that what Trumbull said has even more bearing today, because I believe that this is much like the Johnson impeachment. It's manufactured until you build a record. I'm not saying you can't build a record, but you can't do it like this. And you can't impeach a president like this.